Hi, my name is Connie Arzigian, and I'm an archaeologist with the Mississippi Valley Archaeology Center. I'm coming here today to talk about bifaces. What are bifaces? We have many artifacts in our collections, like these projectile points or some of these knives, and these are all bifaces, and I'll tell you what that means in a minute. But how do we get from something that looks this beautiful from an original stone that's just a large block of stone? So I want to talk about some of that process, some of what comes off, some of the different stages along the way that the workers went to do this, and some of the tools that they used, some of the mistakes that we can learn how they were doing this process so they can get to this final product. So what do we mean by a biface? Every region has different terms on how to describe these, but basically what it means is a biface has two faces. It has two parallel faces like this, the top and the bottom. There's usually not a clear difference between those, the top and the bottom, and it's symmetrical around a line. So there's a midline that's running down the center of this biface, and all of the work that's been done has been symmetrical to make this midline centered. You think about a knife, you've got a centered line for your biface. So that's one characteristic. And the other characteristic is that it should be relatively thin compared to its width. So you want something that's not really thick in the middle, so it makes it easier to use as a cutting tool or as a projectile to shoot animals. So those are some of the main characteristics that we're going to be using. Now, flint knapping is hard, and a lot of times we don't hit the stone right or it breaks. We have other kinds of problems. This artifact snapped very late in the process of making things. So when we see those errors, we can kind of figure out from the archaeological record how people were making the things. And that's what we're going to talk about, is some of the different stages that they went to make their artifacts. So how does a rock go from a thick, chunky rock to a finely flaked biface or a final projectile point? It's a process of removing flakes in a systematic manner from both faces. And I have here an experimental stone where I can show how this process works. This usually is done with what we call direct percussion. So I might use a hammer stone on a larger artifact, or in this case, an antler on a smaller artifact like this, where I would hit the stone with the antler to drive a flake off underneath this material. And I've done that here. This is an experimental one that was done earlier, so I can show the process. I hit it here, right at this point of impact, and what's going to happen is this flake is going to come off, and it's going to leave a bulb of percussion on this side. So you can see the bulb up here, and you can see the negative bulb that's left in the rock. So this is how we're going to get this kind of winding and twisting edge along the rock, to have the positive bulb and the negative bulb along this line. And we would keep taking flakes off each side of this in order to get the final product. We can look at an artifact that has had flakes taken off of all the faces, and we can see some of the evidence of these flake removals. And so what we're going to be looking at is, you can see each time a rock is hit, there's actually ripple marks that penetrate into the center of the rock. These are like pebbles thrown into the water will send ripple marks out. There are ripple marks in the stone to see all of these things. And so we can track each of the flake scars and tell where it came from and how it was removed. And we can see here on this large artifact that there were flakes removed from the whole surface to thin the center of it and to align this edge. What are the stages in making a biface? It might start off as a thick block of stone, or it might start as a larger flake from an even larger stone. So this is a flake of obsidian. Here's the bulb of percussion that we just talked about. But this itself could be made into a different kind of a tool. Could also start as a large rock, a large flat surface. This is an example of something that was a large flat surface. It started as a tabular piece. This is outer weathering grind or cortex on both faces. So this started as a thick slab of rock that somebody has taken flakes off of several sides to make into an early stage of biface. And this is another example of one of those. We can tell this started as a tabular piece of stone or a flat chunk of stone because it has outer weathering rind, the cortex on both faces, and they've tried to remove flakes from each side. So we have a flake that came off of here, and one that came off of here, and one 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 off of here, and so forth. So they're working this down, and this midline that I talked about is sinuous. It's kind of snaking back and forth. So that's an early stage in this process, just roughing out the shape of it with a few flakes taken off of both faces. In that process, you might get lots of good flakes that you could use to many different kinds of tools. So the flake products from this would be very helpful as cutting tools in their own right. As you keep working the stone, you're going to get something that has more flakes that were taken off. So you can see here and here and here and here and here and here. And this edge, this midline, is getting better aligned in the center. It's more rippled marks. There's more actual flakes taken off to kind of center that. This is another example that's getting further developed. We have flake there and there and here and here. So we're kind of centering this midline. That's the process that they're trying to work on. They're trying to get it thinner. It didn't work very well with this one. It's still kind of thick, but they're trying to center that midline. This is a much later stage of biface where you have lots of flakes taken off of both faces, and there's lots of different flakes across this edge, a lot of very tiny flakes to shape the edge, and that center line is getting pretty straight. It's a pretty straight, regular midline there. So they're accomplishing their goal of making this into a kind of well-aligned biface. So we can see that that's one of the processes of doing that. Along the way, they might have accidents. This one snapped, which was unfortunate, so that kind of stopped that process. So we have a sequence of stages along the way. And some people will try to organize these into more formal categories, but they don't necessarily have to have a formal difference in a specific stage between this one and this one. It's kind of a continuum. You keep taking flakes off, you keep getting more and more refined in your product. So we would call all of these things preforms. They're not quite finished tools. Some of them are pretty early in this process of being a preform. Some of them are pretty late. But they're all going to be different steps along that way of going from a chunk of rock to a much more finished tool. But you can't just shape the edge of a biface. You have to work the center of it to make sure that it stays thin enough overall that it can be usable, that you can haft it or that you can use it as a knife. So the trick for that is to make sure that you're not taking flakes just off the edge. You're getting the flakes to extend over the whole center of the piece. And I'm working here with an experimental piece that somebody made for me that has flakes that take off the whole center to reduce this thickness. We see in the archaeological record sometimes that people had a hard problem with that. This is an example of something that was discarded. It's got a really big lump in the middle because the flakes that they took off hit a fracture plane right there, and the flake couldn't go any further. It couldn't take off this middle lump. So you've got a really thick lump in there, and they just discarded it. They couldn't use it. There's some other examples of artifacts that had a thick spot in the middle. They just couldn't get around it, so they abandoned it. So one of the things that we're going to demonstrate here is how that process is supposed to work. So here I have a biface that was made for me by an experienced flint knapper, and there's a ridge down the middle. There's a lump down the middle right here that they want to get rid of. You can see that there's a high point right here, and they want to get rid of it. Well, that's tricky to do, but the way to do it is to take a flake from here and drive that flake all the way across the middle to take out this lump. And so what they did was they had this stone, they used an antler, and they hit it very carefully right there, and this flake came off. So you can see here, this flake took off the ridge and it thinned down the center of the biface. So now we have a nice thin biface. They'll do the same thing. They could have taken the same thing to take this ridge off. So this flake is what we'd call a biface thinning flake. It extended over the center of the biface to take out that bump in the middle. And that's what you need to do in order to thin your artifacts. So if we look at this obsidian blade that we looked at before, we can see that there are flake scars that extend past the midline. They go all the way over here. They're not just working on the edge. They're going into the center and across the center of this to thin this biface, to thin the center of it so that it ends up being a nice, relatively thin artifact rather than something that just gets narrower and narrower and thicker, like some artifacts in the past when the footnappers couldn't get rid of those bumps, and so they abandoned the artifacts. What transforms this preform into a final tool or something that we would recognize as a projectile point or a knife? This preform could easily be used as a knife, and it probably was. It has a very good cutting edge. It's relatively long. It would have been sharp. They could easily have used this as it was as a knife for as long as they needed a knife. But if they needed to make this into some sort of projectile point or a more formal tool, they could do a little bit more work to it. And they would be using, at that stage, what we call pressure flaking, to do the more formal shaping of the edge. So hitting the stone takes off the larger flakes, but to really get the final edge carefully shaped, you would actually go in and pressure flake and push careful flakes off of this edge in order to get a really nice, well-defined edge. And then in order to get the characteristic notches or the stems or other things, you could go in and actually notch those corners. And there's specific tools that they may have used to actually shape these pressure flakes to get the just the final delicate working edge. And they might shape notches. They might shape the edge of this to shape a stem on the point and so forth. Whatever the culture says is the right way to make a projectile point for that time period, they would use these final staging processes to shape the stone exactly the way they needed it. So we can characterize bifaces as stones that were worked on both faces. They have an edge that's been aligned, and they are relatively thin in comparison to their thickness. And what we have here is, to start, maybe a large flake or a block of material that will have a very sinuous edge that goes back and forth. It will get more and more shaped, more and more aligned as we go along until we end up with something that can be used as a different kind of a tool, but is also a preform that if you need a point or a specific kind of knife, you've got the preform. It's ready for you to go. And they come in different sizes depending on what you're working and what you need to do. And we'll see some of them. We get many of them in the archaeological record when they were broken in manufacture, so we can see what the process was. And we would go from that down to the final shaping to actually shape the specific overall form and the notches, whatever kind of configuration, to end up with your final product of your biface, of a point or a knife or something like that in the archaeological record. So for more information about the different kinds of tools and the different kinds of work here, see the other MVAC videos and all the descriptions in the box below.